Hello! It's weird, it's so white, right? It looks like I died and I'm in heaven, but actually I'm in ditch heaven and I haven't died. And today I'm going to share this piece of ditch heaven with you. It's the result of around 2 years of work. And actually, the last 2 years I've been very active as a didgeridoo maker because of Corona, which didn't allow me to perform that much as I used to. And also I got the tiny monsters at home, which somehow put the symbiosis of keeping me at home and discovering the inner world more than the outer. I still play, but in the last 2.5 years, I've been making didgeridoos more than ever in my life. Hopefully this has resulted with some good things. I have quite some things to show you, so I won't talk into depth about each didgeridoo. I'll just tell you the basics, and you can learn more at our website or my didgeridoo website or my music website, which links are in the description. Also, more details about each didgeridoo you will be able to see in the description. So let's start with our most basic model, Kairos. Here we have a black locust fumigated Kairos. It is our silver class model, so it has a silver coin here. And this one has a nice bell trim from, this is a walnut burl, actually, somewhere from the root of a giant walnut. We also have this beautiful hornbeam Kairos, and it is quite special because it has a ebony bell trim, and in the cracks it's filled with black ebony epoxy dust. It should sound very similar to the other Kairos because they are all made in the same way. Now we have something really nice. This is a little bit bigger version of Sumo in D, made in blood with eucalyptus. It has ancient walnut trims at the mouthpiece and the bell. So this one is a bit more voluminous. It has a little bit more open, especially in the lower part, but it's because it's also longer, it's still tuned the same. The wood is harder than the walnut Sumo that is presented on the website, so it has a little bit more of presence in the sound. However, the basic quality, this hugging bass thickness that each Sumo has, is of course present, otherwise it wouldn't be a Sumo. Thank you. this is an ironbark sumo. It is different in a way that it's a tiny little bit tighter up here, and it's a bit longer. Because it's ironbark, it's super, super hard. Not as hard as me, of course, but hard. It has this Palisander Santos trims at the mouthpiece and the bell. It is a bit more concrete in terms of articulations. It has a little bit less bass, a little bit more mids. So when you are carving out the articulations, they would be a bit more clear, but it won't have exactly the same amount, you know, of this bass hug. The other thing I have to point out is that the second tooth is a little bit between the major sixth and minor seventh. On sumo, regular sumo, it's minor seventh. The first tooth is in the octave, right? And then you have a minor seventh on regular sumo, and this one is between major sixth and minor seventh. So it's a little bit off tune, but it doesn't sound bad at all. It's also very nice to play, has a slightly bigger back pressure than the regular sumo, and maybe we would like to hear it, right? Something extremely special. It is like the Kal-El of our didgeridoo line. It is a new shape, and it is in this super hardwood called orchor. If you follow my Facebook page, I've been posting how the process went from this beautiful log, which was the bell end, and then the pilot hole, and then how the hole was expanding. So this is that didgeridoo. It was quite a long research and development process to get to it. It is extremely hardwood, which results in very, very clear sound. You have a lot of high frequencies, they are not absorbed. This is both reflected in the basic spectrum as well as the transients. So your articulations are super precisely carved on this one. The shape is really balanced in a way that it's not too big, it's very well tuned, and also it has a lot of power. You know, it's not super big instrument, but it sounds way bigger than it is. It's like a kind of a miracle, you know. It's really, from my perspective, a super dig. What you can notice also, it has a very special mouthpiece made of pale moon ebony, which has a black spot melting into the black ebony on top, and the rim is black ebony. So it also has this kind of correlating to the knot just 15 centimeters below. It's hard to see the grain properly from the recordings, but it's very, very dense. And it has a lot of chatoyants, and the wood keeps just flowing into itself and out of itself. It's very heavy and very calm when playing. You don't shake the instrument, it shakes the room, but your head is not shaken. Yeah, let's try it, right? Yeah. have here is also something very special, because this is the kind of digits we make. Very special digits. This is Nirvana Spirit Hybrid in D. So it's quite long for a D, but it has this very special tuning where its intrinsic resonances are very close to its harmonic resonances. It is a very precise ditch. It's great for pulling. The toots are very easy. The back pressure is very high. It's super responsive. It's extremely loud, like extremely loud. You can push it unbelievably, you know, so that the pictures fall off the walls. It's very easy to play. It doesn't have as much bass, for example, as Sumo. It is more mid-oriented. And it's also great for playing songs that are very fast and precise. For example, I play Difficult But Possible on a digital like this, or 3020 is played on a Nirvana. So you can play it also in a Nirvana Spirit Hybrid. So it has some properties of Nirvana and some properties of Spirit. It's a bit tighter than Spirit, but has a bell. The lower part is more like Spirit. So it has really, hopefully, the best of both worlds. And these worlds aren't very far apart anyway. I compared it to my Spirit, and it is more clear, more articulate than it. It is made of bloodwood eucalyptus and has Palisander Santos trims on the bell and the mouthpiece. And there are strong bloodlines. So we move away from D into C, and you recognize this here is Moitze, the ultimate universal didgeridoo. That's very important for my personal didgeridoo development when I was playing my first professional songs, but also way later into my career. Up till this point, I still play Moitze. And I created songs like Stink Room, Lake of Awareness with it, but later on also Zelandub and so on. This one is in Beach. It has a very beautiful grain game down here. It has a Vange mouthpiece trim and a walnut trim at the bottom. Moitze is very specific because it has a great punch. It has this medium ground between articulations and speed of tongue and what you can have in the push in the bass. So it's quite equally good for push and pull, and it's great for learning. But also it can give you this professional quality. Like, you won't be embarrassed if you record your album with Moitze. At least I'm not. Feeling of playing, very nice response. And again, at masterclass, I was really impressed how well it sounds. I'm really not embarrassed to offer you this instrument as our basic entry level didgeridoo into world of highest level didgeridoos. The next in line is Sumo in C. It is a bit shorter than Moitse, but it has a bigger volume. So it has more of this juice, it has more of bass, it has more of the hug. So it has everything like a Sumo in D, but more, especially when it comes to depth. This particular one had some inhabitants in this part, but is a very beautiful piece actually of walnut. It belonged to a very big walnut. But because of the inhabitants before, here you can get it at a ridiculously low price. It has ebony mouthpiece, which is on the thin side. It's this precise mouthpieces that I love, rounded at the edge. This is Sensei, actually Slim Sensei, made of Eki, also known as the Zobar Bongosi. It is a super hard ironwood, a red ironwood from Africa. This one is in C as well. It is a little bit tighter than I normally make them. I have to present this shape in a full light in a special video, as it is so special and brings so many nice qualities of both being articulate and precise, but having a very good bass response, as well as quite spectacular air code. This one is a bit tighter, so it's a bit more precise, also due to the hardness of the wood. It's more articulated, more carved out. The highs are very strong, and I would say especially this instrument is very good for recordings. So it is loud, but not as loud as some of the dishes we have, but it has a very well determined dynamic range and very predictable response. So when you bring it to the microphone, you can really control what's happening there. This can be very useful at some points, especially with some wilder playing techniques. You can kind of tame them with this. I would not ever call it soft, but it isn't as loud as Spirit. It is maybe most similar to Moitse, but they have quite different logic. The inner side logic is all the basic dimensions are about the same. So this fat guy next to me is of course a sumo in B, also known as the bumblebee. Now what you get in sumo in B is when fat really gets fat and bass really becomes bass. You know, the impulse response in this is like somebody throwing cream bombs onto you from 10th floor. It has a very beautiful this tongue drumming response. Extreme air code, easier toots than the higher sumos, and maybe, you know, it even captures the essence of sumo better. Like essence of sumo is captured better at B than maybe than at D, though Z has a lot of, you know, goodness from that size, from that weight. And this bigger sibling that didn't go on a diet at all ever just has more of everything, and it's still very easy to play. Not as easy as D, but I would say that there is more advantages of getting this extra thickness than you have disadvantages from losing a little bit of that playability. So let's test it, right?
Yeah.
if best to save for the last, but possibly. This is a bee in ironbark, and it has Palmon mouthpiece and bell trim. It is also very, very bassy, like a sumo, but has more articulation powers. It has really nice back pressure. It's quite loud. It has this super percussive options, you know, both in air code playing and drumming on the drone. It has easier toots than sumo. Maybe tiny little less fat, less bass. And it's overall a beast, but you know, this honey drone beast, it's a honey beast. So let's hear it. So that's it for our collection of Autum 2022, and hopefully we will have one more small release in winter with some deeper sumos, which is a super nice territory of didgeridoo land. This is like a jungle to get lost in for a long time. Also, if you haven't already, please connect to us by subscribing, following us, stalking us in the night. We are not afraid of those things, especially if it's in the forest and nobody see what's going on. But you can do more conventional things like, subscribe, hit buttons and all that. And I'll see you next time. Until then, spiral out. Keep digging.